afternoon.
Yes.
This is a choir of one, or you could be the choir this afternoon. But if you would stand with me, let's turn to page 511 if you need it. Sing about the victory we have in Jesus today.
Shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. Verse 6, and now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When thou sayest, seek ye my face, my heart saith unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me. O God, my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Teach me thy way, O Lord, and lead me in your plain path because of my enemies. Deliver me not over unto the will of my enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breath out cruelty. I have fainted unless I have believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord.
Amen. Amen. I'd like to start with a little song. The Lord just inspired me to sing this song. I used to sing at Walls Chapel in Zion Church. It's called Sweet Holy Spirit. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on his face, and I know they feel the spirit of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I humbly come before you asking that you bless this pastor, Pastor Owens. Cover him from the head, the top of his head to the sole of his feet. May the scripture and the blessing and the sermon he brings to us touch our hearts and remind us that Christ loves us. May we all join together in one unity in the name of Jesus Christ, who loved us and died for all of us. May there be camaraderie between the two churches. May we come together in the name of Jesus to worship him in spirit and in truth. And may we all be blessed. Thank you, Father, for blessing us and loving us before we loved you. Because without you, we wouldn't be here. Without you, Lord, we wouldn't exist. And we thank you for calling us to come to you and asking, what must I do to serve you, Lord? Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. And keep us. And let us do the will that you set out for us to do. Bless this congregation with Gate City. Thank you for their safe travel here and their safe travel going back. May they continue to serve you and do the best that they can to be saints for you. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Some time ago, Jesus called 12 men to be his disciples. And a little bit after that, he told one of them, "Do you love me?" He asked one of them, "Do you love me?" And then he said, "Feed my sheep." We have been doing that for 88 years, directly and indirectly. Good afternoon. Welcome to our 88th celebration of our ushers' ministry. The last time I stood before you to give you a welcome, I wasn't part of the ushers' ministry, but now I am.
Amen.
And I've gotten to realize that there are a lot of work that is put into something that you do for the finished product that you see. For instance, when you come in on Sunday, you will see us standing at the door or in the aisle. We're always ready with a fan or a program or even some tissues to help you out. We're always ready with directions or telling you somewhere where you can sit. And I've come to realize that it's not always easy. Some people don't want to sit where you tell them to sit. If you're not quick enough with the fan, you get a look. And it goes on and on. But in all of that, we have to remember what the Lord said, "Feed my sheep." And we do have to remember who we are representing when we stand up in the aisles or whatever we do, that we are representing our Lord and Savior.
Yes.
And with saying all this, it's not easy. You have learned that you should not wear high heels while standing because your feet hurt. You have learned that you shouldn't get lost when the choir is singing your favorite song and you don't know whether you should dance or stand still in the aisle. And you have learned that you have to pay attention because when the choir is singing and everybody's enjoying themselves, somebody would need a fan immediately because they're sweating. So you have to be on your P's and your Q's when you're an usher. So, and it's not only that, standing on the floor, all the planning that goes in and all the things that we have to do to bring it to the church when we come on Sunday or whatever day that we serve. So I know that it is summer outside and it is hot and you could have been on your back porch with some iced tea watching your kids and your dogs run through the sprinklers, but you have chosen to be here with us this afternoon. So we say thank you. When you come in, we hope that you were welcome. If you weren't, if you didn't feel welcome, we hope you feel welcome now with this welcome that I have given you. If you still not feeling welcome, wait a little while. You will feel welcome. After the message, if you still don't feel welcome, we'll take you to the back and we'll feed you. So you will feel welcome before you leave. Somewhere or the other, we will make sure that you feel welcome when you leave our doors. Thank you for coming, and may God continue to bless you.
Your response?
I just want to say on behalf of Gay City, it's a blessing always for us to be able to worship together. It's also interesting to notice the difference between ushers at Gay City and ushers here at Ebenezer. The bar is a lot lower. if you are single and coming to Gig City hoping to find a prospective spouse from one of our ushers, you will keep looking. Good. My church is just a number of weeks ago.
selection. seniors, when I call your name, if you can just stand if you're present. And if those that are not present, we will move on. Pamela Akins, Myrtle Blackwell, Elise Bartwater, Catherine Jones Brooks, Keith Brooks, Stephanie Crisp, Tracy Dixon, Katie Fawcett, Laura Gladney, Wilma Goins, she's in the back, Sabrina Holloway, Jimmy Hayden, Mahogany Huff, Neil Huntley, Kathy Jenkins, Kerwin Johnson, Johnny Kelly, Dwight Lynch, Pauline Mack, Wanda Martin, Amy Mebbin, Ellis Mebbin Jr., Wilhelmina Milton, okay, she's in the back as well, Dee Serrano, Joretta Simmons, Jacqueline Stevenson, Sherelle Stokes, Roxy Strickland, Marcia Austin, I'm sorry, Brenda Williams, Audrey Wilkerson, Christopher Winstead, Cora Garner, Deanna Winstead, she's in the back, myself, Greg Winstead, Maddie Winstead, Robert Winstead Sr., and Robert Winstead Jr. These are our senior ushers.
Good afternoon. Our Ebenezer Baptist Church Youth Usher Ministry members for 2017. When I call your name, if you're here, please stand. Morgan Goins, Christopher Howard, Ethan Howard, Jamon Hayden, Corey Kelly, Nate Kelly, Alexandria Lenny, Antonio Lenny, Ashton Lenny, Jacob Simmons, Jessica Simmons, Brandon Steele, Nakia Scott, Davis Winstead, Nina Winstead, Jalen Winstead, Benjamin Woods, and Sarah Woods. Our 2017 Ebenezer Baptist Church.
History, I'm just going to kind of sum it up right quick. Senior Usher Ministry history has been blessed from the beginning by God and numerous faithful leaders whose names you will see scrolling on the screen behind me. Each of these leaders were guided by the Holy Spirit to organize and enrich the usher board here at Ebenezer from 1929 to the current year, 2017. Through God's grace, the senior and junior usher ministry continue to give spiritual and moral support to our church. Be it resolved that a detailed copy of our history will be kept in our records, and that we as ushers will never forget those who laid the foundation for the senior and junior usher ministry here at Ebenezer. All right. Now comes the part where we can all take part. And that will be our offering. We could have some officers to come forward. Thank you.
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Lord, first of all, just thank you for blessing this ministry for 88 years. We know, Lord, that was no small feat, Lord, but we know that as long as they have trusted in you, they've carried out your word, Lord, and for that we thank you. We thank you for this opportunity to be of what is already yours, Lord, whether it be monetarily or just helping someone else. We ask that you continue to be with us, bless those that have to give, bless those that desire to give, and bless those that don't have. But Lord, above all, we just thank you for the gift that you've already given us that are saved. And for that, we can never repay you. But we just want to say thank you and give you honor and glory. In Jesus Christ's name, we do pray, Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us stand, please. Be led by the ushers from the rear.
We now have the introduction of our speaker, by Pastor Howard Woods.
First, I want to thank Gate City for coming out and fellowshipping with us another year, just giving a praise in the senior nursery, junior nursery ministry. I'm here to introduce my friend, Pastor Michael Owens. I got up and I realized I was supposed to do this, and I asked him, what you want me to say? I think he said, just make up something. So really, I'm just going through all my minds of the things I could say. The other day, my family asked, who's going to be preaching? Who's going to be ministering? I said, Pastor Owens of Gate City. And one of my daughters said, oh, he's still there? So, I think it's a good thing that he's still here, and I'm excited to have him. The family of Gate City with us today. If you heard Michael Owens, you're going to be blessed. If you haven't, you're going to be blessed. He speaks from his heart. I really believe he loves the Lord with his whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. And I'm excited to account him as a friend. I really feel comfortable around him. There's not a lot of preachers that you get around. Sometimes you get around preachers and you feel all stoic, and you know, they start talking, and I was preaching this morning in platitudes, praise the Lord, hallelujah, and you know, it just doesn't feel right. But Pastor Owens, thank you for being real, sincere, and we expect a wonderful word from the Lord today. Just let God use you. So without further ado, I introduce the son, and his others, my friend, the good reverend, Dr. Michael Owens, of the great first Gate City Baptist Church in Greensboro, North Carolina. Will you hear you? I'm redeemed. Oh,
thank God for redeeming.
Much of a traveler, but anytime I go on a trip, I have a problem, and the problem is that I'm a notorious overpacker. Anybody like that? And it's not simply that I need to make sure that I've got clothes for every day that I'm gone. I feel like I need to make sure that the contingencies are taken care of as well, so that if you're going to be gone for 5 days, not only do you need 5 shirts, you might get ketchup on one of those shirts, so you need at least another. You might get mustard on those pants. You may need another pair. As if that were not enough, I also have this as a great difficulty. I find it almost impossible to try to just decide before the actual day that I'm going to wear something, what I'm going to wear. So because of that, what I wind up doing is taking options. Have you pack options? For example, I was at children's camp, helping chaperone our group that was just there this past week, and I brought home 3 clean pairs of shorts and 3 shirts. Now, I wore something different, but I brought that much home clean just because I took options. Now that wasn't a big deal because we had pulled a trailer behind the van and there was plenty of luggage space and you could take honestly as much as you wanted and the kitchen sink if you wanted to. That was no big deal. I remember a couple years ago I had to go to Nashville though for a conference and I did not want to check any bags, and so I wanted to make sure everything would fit in my carry-on bag. And so I'm setting clothes out in my normal way, and all of a sudden I realize not everything is going to be able to go. For me to get from where I am to where I want to be, I cannot bring along everything. Hold that thought for just a moment. One of the things that we tend to do a decent job of in the church is to point people in the direction of and encourage and invite people to come back to Jesus. We try to point people in His direction in the first place and explain to them how they can become one of His followers, but you and I all know that it's entirely possible, and too oftentimes it is a reality, that those who have a relationship with Christ go through seasons of wandering where they will drift because of choices that they make, because of struggles that they have, because of circumstances that they encounter. They will drift from the Lord, and we will encourage, come back, come back, come back. And we will do so with verses like 1 John 1:9, if you'll confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive your sins and to cleanse us and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And all of those things are true. We do a good job of saying come back. We do a good job of inviting to come back. But what we tend to do a lousy job of is instructing and guiding people on how to stay back when you get back. That's what I want you to think with me about a little bit this afternoon. And I think we see what's involved in returning and staying back with the Lord in 2 Kings. If you would look with me in your Bibles there today, 2 Kings chapter 23. And the text is going to be much longer than we will actually look at in full. But we'll start to get some verses just on the table of your mind so that you can understand what's going on. 2 Kings chapter 23. Starting with verse 4. Let me set the stage for you. This is in the southern kingdom. It's Judah. Josiah is now the king of Judah, and he became king at the ripe old age of 8 years old. He became king because his father was assassinated, and all of a sudden the reins of leadership are thrust into his lap. Hey, now you're 8 years old, you are the king. Congratulations. And you can imagine how it worked for the first period of years. I mean, he doesn't know anything. He's 8 years old. I mean, my kids do well to be able to get their clothes in their drawers, much less run a country, much less run a nation. And so at 8 years old, you can imagine probably the handlers are essentially making all the decisions. But as he ages, as he matures, you can imagine also that he's beginning to assume more and more and more responsibility taking on and taking back many decisions that a lot of the handlers had been making. By the time he is 16 years old, he begins to start thinking and asking some spiritual questions, thinking beyond himself, thinking big picture type things, wondering about the existence of God and thinking spiritual questions. By the time he is 26, he's had 10 years of questioning, 10 years of pondering, 10 years of thinking and considering the nation's history. And at this point, he decides that there's a problem. Something needs to be done because the temple has been built many years before, but it's in dire need of repair. It has fallen into terrible condition. And so what he does is to order a series of renovations. I mean, this place has become a dump. And so he recognizes, at the very least, this is a historical structure. This is a historical, important building for our people in terms of our lineage. We need to fix this place back up. And so that's what happens. And it wasn't because he was necessarily trying to find the Lord. It wasn't because, of his desire to do something overtly spiritual. This was more of a historical type thing. This is more of a building project. But what's interesting is that what was intended as a renovation project, thank you so much, as a renovation project, and what began as a construction effort, God uses to great effect, because what happens is that there's a discovery made. You ever clean stuff out and find something?
Yes.
That might be where your offering came from this afternoon. Yeah. They discovered something. They found a copy of God's Word to show you just how far they had gotten from God. Nobody had any idea if there was a copy of God's Word, and if there was, where it would be. I mean, for generations they have drifted, and they are so, so very far from God. Collectively they are. That all of a sudden somebody finds a copy of God's Word, what we would know as the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. And somebody sees it and thinks, hey, this is, I don't know what this is, the king might ought to see this. So they bring this to the king, and the king begins to read the words of God, and it speaks to him in his core. It breaks him. It causes him to realize this spiritual quest that he's been on, he's discovered the one that he's been looking for. And all of a sudden, what he does is that he has these words read, and he gathers the nation together. And he has the Word of God read. You see this in verse 1 of chapter 23. The king sent all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem were gathered to him. And the king went up to the house of the Lord, and with all the men of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the priests, the prophets at the temple, both great and small. And he read in their hearing all of the words of the book of the covenant that had been found in the house of the Lord. And so they're hearing God's word for the very first time. They are so far from God. Even as the people of God, so far from having heard the word of the Lord, they're hearing it for the first time. And in verse 3, the king stood by the pillar and made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and soul. So what Josiah does now, he's 26 years old, and he has had his heart penetrated by the truth of what God has revealed. And he makes this decision publicly. He says, as for me, I'm with him. And this speaks to me and tells me that I am so miserably and so horribly out of bounds that I am going to get my act together. And he has established a pattern and practice of expectations that he wants me to follow, that he expects me to follow, and by his grace I will follow. That is what I am deciding to do. And what you see is what follows. At the end of verse 3, all the people joined in the covenant. It's great news. Great news. What started as a renovation project, as an episode of this old house, has brought about the greatest revival that this generation has ever, ever seen. And for the first time in generations, people not only have a copy of God's Word, they are reading God's Word, and they are affected by God's Word, and they return to Him. And that's what we tend to be decent at, if we're even good at that, to tell people that there's a God that you have strayed from and invite and woo them to come back. The question is, how do you keep them back when you get there? Read with me, starting in verse 4. It says, the king commanded Hilkiah, the high priest, and the priest of the second order, and the keepers of the threshold, to bring out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels made for Baal, for Asherah, and for all the host of heaven. He burned them outside Jerusalem in the fields of the Kidron, and carried their ashes to Bethel. And he deposed the priest whom the kings of Judah had ordained to make offerings in the high places, at the cities of Judah and around Jerusalem. Those also who burned incense to Baal, to the sun, the moon, and the constellations, all the host of heavens. He brought out the Asherah from the house of the Lord outside Jerusalem to the brook Kidron. He burned it at the brook and beat it to dust and cast the dust of it upon the graves of the common people. What continues then for the next nearly 20 verses is a whole series of things that begin to happen once they have decided they're going to return to God. They've made the commitment. And not simply that we want to return to God, but Josiah is deciding if we're going to stay with Him, something has got to happen. And here's the first thing. You must jettison ungodly things. You must jettison ungodly things. This text gives us all of the specifics as to what was in the temple that they get rid of. And he starts in verse 4, that there are these vessels. These are the instruments. This is the paraphernalia, if you will, of idol worship. And so they're worshiping the pagan god Baal. They're worshiping the pagan Asherah. And to do so, they've got all these bowls, and they've got these cisterns, and they've got these lampstands. They've got all this stuff that is in the temple. Keep in mind, this is the place reserved that was specifically and overtly built for the worship of God. And all this junk is in there. And Josiah says, this junk has got to go. All this mess that was used for Baal, for Asherah, that has to go. It says that he burned them. So all this stuff, it goes up in flames. And not only do the ashes not even stay near the temple, they don't even stay in town. The ashes get done. In verse 5, it says, he deposed the priest whom the king of Judah had ordained to make offerings in the high places at the cities of Judah and around Jerusalem. So his predecessors, his father, his grandfather, his great-grandfather, and those that preceded them, they had, in essence, they had created this entire workforce of priests whose sole task was to lead the nation of Judah in the worship of these false gods. So you would have priests for Baal, you'd have priests for the Asherah, you'd have priests for all of these various and sundry gods. And what Josiah does is to send every one of them to the unemployment line. He says, there's no place for you in this country. This, your job is now done. Your work is now completed. Hit the road, Jack, because this is not going to be found in Judah anymore. And then it says, those who burned incense to Baal, to the sun and to the moon and the constellations and all the hosts of heaven, that gives you just an idea of how pantheistic they have become. They're worshiping anything they possibly can. They're worshiping Baal. They're worshiping Asherah. They're worshiping the moon, the moon god, the sun god, the various stars, this whole pantheon of gods they have been worshiping, and doing so even in the temple itself. And what does he do? It says he gets rid of all this junk. Verse 6, he says, brought out the Asherah. The Asherah is essentially a totem pole. And so there in the temple is this massive totem pole that people in the temple would have come to bow down and offer sacrifices and offer offerings to this thing that has been built by human hands. And what does he do? He has that thing carted out of the temple, carted out of town. They burn it, and then they take the ashes and scatter those on the graves of those who used to worship this false god. As if that were not enough, verse 7 says, he broke down the houses of the male cult prostitutes who were in the house of the Lord. So what went on is that the temple was not just a building, it was a sprawling complex. Now within the complex, there were effectively dormitories for male prostitutes. Well, isn't that nice? So here in the place that is reserved for the worship of God, you have all of this pagan filth and moral filth in the house of God. And so what Josiah does is that the male prostitutes, they got to get out of town. And where they live, that stuff gets demolished. This is not to be found in the house of God. In verse 10, he tears down an altar known as the Topheth. And the Topheth was this altar where human sacrifices had been offered to the pagan god Molech. What's going on? I mean, the people of God have been involved in human sacrifice to a pagan false god? How in the world does this happen? They have drifted that far from God. But now they've returned, and Josiah says, all of this junk has got to go. And it not only goes, it gets demolished. It gets destroyed. It gets tossed. And this goes on for verse after verse after verse, which again leads us to the first thought, which is that if you're returning to God and you're going to stay there, you've got to jettison ungodly things. We get all the specifics, but we do well to step out and broaden our view and ask this question. What exactly is it that Josiah gets rid of? In short, the answer to that question is this. Anything that would take the people's attention off of the Lord. If it would keep them from looking towards Him, then that needed to go. That got burned. That got scattered. That got taken out of town. Last year, when it went on forever, it seemed, my wife was on this diet. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's called the Daniel diet. And I don't know if you remember the story from Daniel about how he wouldn't eat the king's food. And all he would eat was not all this rich, lavish stuff. It was essentially just vegetables. And so, essentially, if it tastes good, Daniel didn't eat it. And neither was Carolyn. And so, the good thing was this. She was very gracious to me and to our children. And that was that, like for supper, she essentially made two meals. There was what we would eat, and then this other stuff. And she would eat that. And sometimes I would wonder, how in the world do you do that? Because a lot of stuff, I mean, she was making for us. And she really makes a really good, I mean, I love her spaghetti. Or she would, we would have hamburgers. So we'd have all just the stuff that's really good. And stuff that I knew that she liked. And after this has gone on for a period of months, I said, you know, how in the world have you done this? I'm like, well, was there anything that was particularly hard for you? And she said, the only thing that got me, the only time I got close to breaking, was if or when we would cook those Totino's pizzas. Not Totino's pizzas on. I'm not talking about like good frozen pizzas, like the Sorno. I'm talking about the dollar Totino's pizzas. And you know, they're about this big. And the meat on it, I mean, I don't know if it's meat. It's and like you'll see pepperoni in little squares, like in kind of little chunk. I liken Totino's pizzas to McDonald's cheeseburgers, and by that I mean this: if you are craving a hamburger, you're not craving a McDonald's cheeseburger, are you? You know something about that. Now you understand that, but you also understand this: McDonald's cheeseburger is pretty good in its own right. I mean, it's like it's in its own category. And I don't know, I'm not hungry right now, but if you offer me a McDonald's cheeseburger, I'm just going to eat it. And I'll say, that's pretty good. If you're craving pizza, you're not craving Totino's pizza. But in its own right, it's pretty good. And so Caroline said, it wasn't the spaghetti, it wasn't the hamburgers, it wasn't anything else. She said, but a couple of times when those Totino's pizzas would be in the oven. And I don't think about that thin, crispy crust. Those little square pepperonis. That was about all I could do. And during that time, after that episode, you could find lettuce and yogurt, cabbage, celery, carrots, and Lord only knows why, but tons of cauliflower. You would find that in our house. You could find some turkey and you could find some chicken. But you know what you would not find? Totino's pizza. You know why? it's hard to get tripped up by what's not around. I don't know why somehow we tend to operate as though we are stronger than we actually are. But we're really not that strong. Josiah understood that about himself and about his people. We have pledged, I have pledged before the Lord that I am coming back, and I'm going to take seriously his standards, his expectations, and his laws. His people said, Josiah, we are right there with you. We are in this. Sign us up. Put my name on the line. But thankfully, Josiah didn't just say, and that's where a lot of times we just stop. We say, oh, the commitment is all you need. Just say, I want to do that. They took it a step further and said, it's not enough just for us to make the commitment. We've got to live the commitment. And for us to live the commitment, there's some stuff that has got to go. And anything that may trip us up, that may divert our attention from the Lord, it cannot be found among us. You say, well, Michael, it's an interesting thought, but as for me, I don't really know what to do with this. Because at my house, the closest thing that we get to a burnt offering is an overcooked meatloaf. And the tool shed has got some extra lawnmower parts in it, but no male prostitutes out there. So what do I do with this? You may not have a totem pole in this building or in your home. You may not have an altar to a false god around your bird bath. But in all likelihood, there's some stuff in your life right now that has no business for somebody who has made the pledge to the commitment, Lord, I'm with you. It may be that it's some stuff on TV. It may be that it's some really popular shows. But shows that may glorify lifestyles that God has said are abhorrent to him. Maybe The Bachelor is your show. Maybe it's Family Feud is your show. I've seen enough clips of Family Feud to know my kids can't watch it. And if my kids can't watch it, I don't have any business watching it. Maybe it's not that. Maybe it's movies. Maybe movies are your thing. Maybe it's particularly horrific, gore, and violence. You just love it. But you know that's got no place in your life. Maybe it's unfiltered internet access that keeps tripping you up. Maybe it's romance novels. Guys don't understand that. There's probably some ladies here that understand the attraction. Maybe it's nothing in that realm. Perhaps in your household, what it is that detracts your attention from the Lord is athletics. I can't tell you the number of families that I have seen make an idol not out of human hands and as a totem pole to bow down and worship. But they've taken the soccer field and the volleyball court and the basketball court and the baseball field, and they've made a god out of that. And the reason I can tell you that is because every time, and I mean every time, that there is a potential conflict. If it's something, excuse me, of God and it's something of sports, who always gets the back seat? Maybe something's out of kilter. Maybe something needs to go. Maybe it's for you. Maybe it's stores. Maybe it is that the home shopping network is keeps tripping you up and is prompting you to be such a lousy, horrible steward of what God has put into your hands. Maybe it's just TV in general, that you're so consumed with it that somehow there's strangely enough time to watch your shows, to keep up with your stories, or whatever it is that you want to watch. Somehow there's strangely enough time for that, but there's never enough time to just open God's Word and see what He has to say, or never enough time just to talk to Him and say, Lord, I need to talk to you. Maybe it's personal habits. There's something that's a regular part of your life that is harmful to your body, and God has convicted you of it, but it still remains. God has burdened you about it, but it remains. I don't know what it is that God is saying to you right now, but I believe that right now there are things that God is showing you that I could never could. That I don't know the details. I can't. I'm not peeking over your shoulder. But God, through the person of the Holy Spirit, is showing you right now, this is something in your life that is diverting your attention from me. And if you're serious about staying with me, well, you've got to jettison ungodly things. But there's one more thing that's required, and it's equally as simple. You've got to jettison ungodly people. You've got to jettison ungodly people. Back in verse 5, it says that Josiah deposed the priest whom the kings of Judah had ordained to make offerings in the high places. So again, kings who have come before him have instituted this system, and they've employed scads of people to serve, and they have given tons of jobs out for people whose sole purpose is to direct people away from the worship of God and to make possible their worship of false gods. Josiah says to them, you're out of work. That there is absolutely no place for you going forward. In verses 19 and 20, you read that Josiah removed all the shrines, also the high places that were in the cities of Samaria, which the kings of Israel had made. So Samaria, that's in the northern kingdom, it has already fallen, but Josiah still has influence in that area, so he gets all the altars that were in the cities of Samaria, which the kings of Israel had made, that had provoked the Lord to anger. And he did to them according to all that he had done at Bethel. It says he sacrificed all the priests of the high places who were there on the altars and burned human bones on them. And then he returned to Jerusalem. So what he does in Samaria, these priests of false gods, he has them executed and then their bodies are burned. That's a pretty good sign. We don't want you around here. Right? Verse 24, it says that, moreover, Josiah put away all the mediums and the necromancers. Well, who are these people? A necro, gives us the Latin prefix, which communicates the idea of dealing with that which is dead. So these were individuals who purported the ability to communicate with those who have already died and to deal with individuals on the other side. They're operating in a very dark spiritual realm. They are dealing with dark spirits and dark forces. And what does Josiah do? He says, you've got to go. You've got to go. The household gods and the idols and all the abominations that were in the land of Judah and Jerusalem, he gets rid of all of this. What I'm saying very simply is that it was not merely the ungodly things that Josiah got rid of. It was ungodly people. People who would tell the people of God the wrong is right. People who would lead them away from the Lord instead of staying back close to Him. So where does this leave us? Where does this leave you? Is this an encouragement either from God's Word or from me personally suggesting to you that you just need to shun everybody and just kind of live essentially in a commune, only among and only with those who think just like you, who view God and the world around us just like God does and how His Word does, that we just completely isolate ourselves. Now, I don't think that's the expectation or the admonition whatsoever. I mean, God wants us to be salt and light in a dark world. We cannot do that when we completely isolate ourselves. But what I want you to understand, though, is something that is true of each of us, which is this. There are lots of people that we know at a few basic different levels. Each of us, and some have more in this group than others, but each of us has a pretty significant number of people that we know on a very basic level. These are individuals about whom you know that at least their first name. You may know their last name, but probably not a whole lot more. This may be somebody that works for the same company that you do, and maybe every once in a while you're on the elevator together, or maybe every once in a while you're in the break room together, or maybe every once in a while you speak to them on the phone because something in your department crosses paths. Maybe it's somebody who lives a couple of streets over from you in your neighborhood or down on the first floor in your complex. I don't know. But this is, we all have these people that we just know kind of vaguely. Maybe it was somebody that you used to go to school with, that you are now Facebook friends with, but you hadn't seen them in 40 years. You just kind of like seeing how much fatter and how much older they look than you, so that's why you're friends with them on Facebook. And so, but you don't really know them, right? You know something about them. At best, you're just kind of acquaintances. And so there's that big sphere of people, and it's got a pretty sizable number in it. Some of you have a lot of people in that, but even those who know the fewest number, there's a decent number of people in that group. But then there is a smaller circle of people that you know much, much better. These are individuals where you not only know their first name and last name, you know something about their family. You may know how many children they have and maybe where their kids are in school. You are somebody, this is someone that you may talk to on a more regular basis. Someone that when you're thinking about who to send Christmas cards to, you're going to make sure that this person or that family is on your list. It doesn't mean that you're bosom buddies with them, but you're pretty close. You're pretty close. They know a fair amount about you. You know a fair amount about them, and you know you're grateful for that relationship. In that sphere of influence, it's a lot smaller number of people than the first group. But then there is this other group that's much, much smaller. And these are people outside your family that you are really close with. And these are the people that when something big happens, whether it's good or bad, you're dialing them up. You got to tell them about it. This is somebody that is going to be a guest in your home, perhaps on a regular basis. This is somebody that's going to invite you over to their house. This is somebody that you may get together with to celebrate New Year's with, or maybe if your family can't come in town, you may celebrate Christmas together. That this is somebody that you talk to on a regular basis, and you know what makes them mad, you know what makes them happy. If you had to go out and buy something as a gift for them, you know something that they would like. You know what gets under their skin, you know what puts a smile on their face. You know that person, and they feel the same way about you. What I'm saying is this, that group you have to guard carefully. That group you have to guard diligently. Why? Because that group you are paying the most attention to. These are people that when you are at the crossroads of decision, you're going to call them and say, hey, what do you think about this? It's this group of people that you're going to call and say, well, if you were in my shoes, what job opportunity would you take? If you were in my shoes and this person asked you out, would you say yes? If you were in my shoes, what would you do? And even if you're not overtly asking the question, you're actively paying attention to them so that you are modeling many of your own choices and many of your own behaviors exactly like them. I'm saying that group, you must guard diligently and ensure within that circle there is no one. If you want to walk with and stay close with the Lord, there cannot be anybody in that group that doesn't point you closer to Him. Why? Because bit by bit, they'll influence you. Say, oh, no, it won't happen. It can happen in the simplest of ways. Each of us has our own oddities and quirks, and or at least maybe y'all do. I don't know how many I've got, but my wife has some. How about that? And this is a strange oddity, I suppose. I discovered it actually in the days right after we got married. For our honeymoon, we got married back in 2004, and we went on a cruise. The best vacation we ever had. It was wonderful. And in fact, I remember when we got off the boat, we said, you know, we'll do this again for like our 10th anniversary. And so we're coming up on 13 years. The only thing we've had is a stack of kids. And so, anyway, but we're on this cruise, and it was just wonderful. And I don't know if you've ever been on a cruise or not, but you've got a staff on the boat that has come from here, yonder, and everywhere. I mean, tons of people from tons of different countries. And beyond that, you've got a lot of people from different countries who have come here to the United States just to get on that boat to go on that particular trip. And so you're meeting people from a lot of different places. And there were these two older ladies that Caroline and I met early in the week who were from London. And I don't know about you, but I love to hear British people talk. And I don't know why, but their English sounds so much better than our English. It just does. And I don't know if they're smarter than we are, but they just sound a lot smarter. And I don't know, these two ladies were probably in their mid to late 70s, but we had met them early on and we just kind of clicked. And they had great senses of humor. We just enjoyed talking with them. And several nights, we wound up having dinner there on the boat with them. In fact, not our last night on the boat, we're having dinner with them. But one of the things that I noticed was this. The more that we were around them, the more my wife was saying things with a British accent. And after we finished dinner with them one night, we got back to the room, I said, "What's up with you and the British accent?" And she said, "I have a problem." And she said, I don't know why, but she says, when I'm around people that have a different accent, the more that I'm around them, the more I start talking like them. It's very strange. It's bizarre. I don't know why it is. I mean, I don't know. She's clearly crazy. Anyway, I don't know why. I don't know why it is that's how it is that she operates. But the principle is this. She says, the more it is that I'm around them, the more it is that I start talking like them. You know, to varying degrees, that is absolutely true for every single one of us. And those within that inner circle that we are closest with, that's the people that we spend the absolute most time with. We are the absolute closest with. And the more that we have those people in that circle that are pointing us away from God, the more it is that over time, and it won't happen overnight, but bit by bit, you step further and further and further and further and further away. And all of a sudden, you wake up as the people of God one day, and it's as if they're hearing the words of God for the very first time. Thankfully, there was a day when, they didn't intend to. There was a construction project. A renovation plan. And somebody discovered the words of God. They read them to the king, and they broke his heart. They affected his heart, and he said, from this day, I'm with him. And the people, after hearing what God had said, after hearing God's word just read, it broke their hearts. It spoke to their heart, and they said to the king, we're with you, and we're with him. But it wasn't merely that they made that commitment, but they made the choice, we're going to come back and we want to stay back. And the only way that can happen is when you jettison ungodly things and when you jettison ungodly people. So how about you? I cannot tell you what those things are in your life. I can't tell you right now if you're even close with or walking with the Lord right now. In fact, there are plenty of people in this room that may think that you and God are just like this, but you know the truth. And it matters not how high you soar when you are here, but it does matter how straight you walk when you leave this place. So what does that you look like? The good news is this, you can come back to the Lord. The invitation from God today is that you can come back. The encouragement is, you should come back. I hope that you will. But it's more than just making a decision today. It's deciding to do the tough stuff going forward. And to, as the Lord through His Spirit speaks to you and says, this needs to go, that you say, Lord, because I want to stay close with you, I want to get rid of it. The ungodly thing, the ungodly person. I'm serious about coming back. I'm serious about staying back. Is that a decision that you are willing to make? You bow your heads with me. Just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. And I'm going to ask, we're not going to sing it. We're just going to have it played. I don't want anything to be a distraction from you. I know that this is a place, geographically, this building is a place that is special to you, especially even to the folks at Gate City. But in the scheme of things, this is not particularly sacred real estate. Just a building, just a plot of land. But I will say this, there is something special about kneeling in the presence of the Lord. And it may very well be that the Lord has spoken to your heart. And And he showed you some things that I never could. He's, when I talk about a name, or when I talk about people, it's not just something generally that goes through. There are specific names, specific faces that come to mind. I talk about some ungodly things. It's not just things in general. There are specific things that God is showing you. A lot of times we talk about spring cleaning. It's far from spring right now. It's the dead heat of summer. I'm telling you, it's a great day to do some cleaning out. What it is that God is guiding you to do, my prayer is that you'll decide and commit, Lord, I want to return and I want to stay close with you. Lord, for your word, we're grateful. For the example of somebody that assumed the reins of leadership at just 8 years old, you used in profound, amazing ways. We're grateful that you did a work in his life, in the life of the people of his day. But Lord, your work is not merely confined to the pages of an old book. Your work is continuing in this present day, in this very moment, among us who profess to be your followers. And I pray, Lord, as you are even right now speaking to our hearts and showing us specific choices that you want us to make, Lord, for the kingdom's sake and for our own well-being and for the sake of our walks with you, I pray, God, that we will follow as you lead. We commit this time of decision to you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Debbie if she would just begin to play. And I'm just going to ask if you would just keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed. And if you don't need to pray for you, you pray for somebody around you. That if the Lord is speaking to them, that they will respond. If there's a decision he's leading them to make, that they too will make. And so as Debbie plays, as the Lord speaks to you, you respond to that.
Have any final remarks per se. I just thank all my ushers for their obedience and willingness to help us do what we need to do to make the service go smooth for Pastor Woods. With that said, I'll give my remarks to Pastor Woods.
I think I'm supposed to say the blessing. Smiled off of Ben when I said that. Thank you for being here today. I know there's a thousand other places you could have been without having to go into a 1,000-degree heat to get here, but I'm grateful that you did. And we're just plain grateful to be able to worship together with you. As I've said this repeatedly, though, it's always good to remind ourselves we are not islands unto ourselves. We each have a section of the wall, and it's grateful for some of the wall builders to get together sometime. I'm grateful for it. Pray with me. Lord, we're thankful to you for this opportunity we've had together today to worship you together, to celebrate you together, to celebrate the fact that you've called people to be used by you. Truth is, there's not a blessed thing that we do that you are absolutely dependent on us to get done. Because you can do anything that we do without us, and you can do it better than we can. But you've chosen in your sovereignty to use us, and we just say thank you for that. Thank you for an opportunity to worship and fellowship together. We're getting ready here in just a few moments to be able to share some food, and we recognize that even that has come from you because you're good to us. For those whose gift is hospitality, and they have prepared and worked and labored to make this possible, we're grateful for them. And so for that and for all of this, we say thank you, and we do so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Said, you can consider yourselves dismissed. You can go through this door right here and head back to our fellowship hall for the repast.